NASA is building ther most powerful rocket ever built, and it's considered within the grand scale of the best. However, it took almost a decade and tens of billions of dollars to get to this point. NASA's costly dream of going back to the moon seems to be a little more positive as its Titanic Space Launch System, or SLS, finally reached the launch pad. Meanwhile, Elon Musk and SpaceX are hard at work on their own giant Starship rocket, meant to one day bring humans to Mars. NASA made history in 1969, when Apollo 11 sent humans to the moon and now the Space Launch System. SLS is the backbone of NASA's new human spaceflight program, Artemis, which is currently aiming to put humans back on the moon by 2025. SpaceX has equally lofty goals. The company is testing the Starship, a fully reusable rocket capable of sending humans to the moon, Mars and beyond. Despite their different goals, the SLS and Starship serve surprisingly similar purposes. Even more surprising, when you consider how NASA plans to use Starship to land the astronauts on the moon. As these two rockets shoot for the moon, here's how they compare. Firstly, we need to talk about the important specifications, including their size and power. SLS is slightly complicated in that it's expected to come in various combinations. Its first variation, Block 1, will stand about 322 feet tall, and weigh 5.75 million pounds when it launches. Block 1 will produce 8.8 million pounds of thrust, which is 15% more than Saturn V produced. It will be able to send more than 27 metric tons, or 59,500 pounds into orbit beyond the moon. In its Block 2 configuration, SLS will produce 9.5 million pounds of thrust and will be able to lift more than 46 metric tons, or 101,400 pounds to deep space. Starship is set to be taller than SLS, standing at 394 feet, with its cargo and booster stage combined. According to SpaceX, its super heavy booster stage will be able to provide 17 million pounds of thrust. Orbital capacity figures publicly available on the NASA and SpaceX websites aren't directly comparable. For example, NASA says SLS will be able to launch 46 metric tons to deep space. While SpaceX says Starship will be able to launch more than 100 metric tons into low Earth orbit. This is complicated by the fact that SLS is intended to go straight to its destination, while there's plans for Starship to reach Earth orbit, refuel via another Starship and then continue its journey, which would boost its range and payload capability. However, an important aspect, the SLS is not a reusable system. The Starship, on the other hand, aims to be SpaceX's first fully reusable rocket. The Falcon 9 and Falcon Heavy had an expendable second stage. Next, how much does it cost to launch and how is it progress compared to the plan? The SLS won't come cheap. Since 2005, NASA has spent more than $50 billion developing these deep space exploration capabilities, and those are just development cost. The operational cost of this vehicle are staggering. Recently, NASA's Inspector General revealed that the cost of flying one Orion and SLS per year was $4.1 billion. This price tag, Inspector General Paul Martin says, was unsustainable for an exploration program. When Congress created the SLS in 2011, it directed NASA to fly the rocket before the end of 2016. The SLS will now launch no earlier than June 2022, more than 5 years behind schedule for the Orion spacecraft. The situation is arguably worse. Spacecraft was intended to fly humans into deep space, and it's unlikely to do so before at least 2024. With the Artemis 2 mission, this means NASA will have spent 2 years developing a vehicle that's essentially a larger, modernized version of the Apollo capsule. Surprisingly, Musk claimed a Starship launch would cost $2 million in turn. No one sure how quickly or how well Starship will work, whereas the SLS rocket looked backward for technology. SpaceX is seeking to leap forward with an even larger, fully reusable vehicle with more lift capacity. A lot of Starship's technology is experimental and cutting edge, so there will be some hiccups along the way, but the pain will be worth the ultimate reward. An efficient rocket and spacecraft that can fly off and for hundreds or even tens of millions of dollars. When SpaceX finally test flies and produces a reliable version of Starship in the next few years, it will disrupt the global launch industry. Previously, the limiting factor for what one might do in space was cost at a price of $4.1 billion per mission, The SLS and Orion embody the concept. When Starship delivers, it will change the fundamental question behind our exploration program, from what can we afford to do in space to what should we do in space. Finally, one thing we need to discuss deeper is the philosophy. To understand why there's so many differences between Starship and SLS production, let's start by putting ourselves in NASA shoes. Frankly, failure is not an option for SLS. NASA, being government-funded, has to do things differently than a private company with private funding. Perhaps the biggest thing they cannot really do is take a big risk. Therefore, the primary philosophy for building SLS is to plan in detail and take minor risk. There's really not much room to fail when you have to answer to the taxpayers why their money literally went up in smoke. And don't forget, NASA's budget is about 0.5% of the US national budget. Actual human spaceflight programs are only a fraction of that. Now compare this to Starship. Starship development is literally as blank of a slate as it gets. SpaceX didn't start with detailed blueprints, it started by just learning which questions to ask. Then how to frame the constraints of what the vehicle should do. Two prime objectives came out of this process. First, be fully reusable. Second, have a capacity large enough to be useful in getting humans to other planets, and that's really about it. Then work backward to find the answers. From there on, the entire thing is basically a playground. Therefore, the iteration speed is why we're seeing so many random things happening at Boca Chica with the development. It is a similar philosophy to something known as the waterfall model, or perhaps the agile model standard in software development, that is Elon's original background. So basically, you don't work on step 2 until you complete step 1. Planning any further ahead, you'll probably undo your work. That's literally the opposite of SLS, where everything needs to have an exact plan. If you end up building the rocket 3 meters shorter than the blueprint, well, now your ground support system has to change. To this exact thing happened with SLS and its mobile launch tower. Besides, Starship production is more flexible, we will see more hardware fail. There will be setbacks, we saw many explosions, but unlike SLS, not only is it okay to fail, it's halfway expected. This approach promotes learning through prototyping at a lower cost and greater speed. Elon has said over and over, approximately, failure is an option here. If things are not failing, you're not innovating enough. This is very similar to the Soviet Union's design philosophy, back in the heydays of Sergei Korolev. Build something as cheap as possible, test it, and if it blows up, see what went wrong. Making improvement and repeat it definitely gave them a leg up during early development. Let's say you blow up a rocket you built in 2 months. You learn from it, then build another one in less time, that it'll take NASA to fuel up and test fire the SLS only once. Thanks for watching this video, and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this, make sure to subscribe. If you have any crazy ideas about what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we'll see if we can get to it. So thanks again for watching and goodbye.